Hello, and welcome to a special segment of Citizens Forum, Tea, Tunes, and Tough Questions with Federal Green Party candidate David Murner, hosted by me, Elise Robinson. Today, I'll be asking questions about who David is, what he would do if elected to Parliament in October, and how he'd do it, all while my lovely friend Jonathan accompanies our discussion. So David, what made you want to run federally in a Esquimalt Saanich Sooke?
There were several things, but one of the key things is the issue of the global climate emergency. The scientists are saying that we have 10 to 12 years at most to address the climate emergency. And so time is short. I have a lot of experience in government, and government 10 to 12 years is a very short period of time to make the major shifts we need. So that was one of the reasons I went to the Greens. The other reason is I used to be a federal Liberal. I volunteered for the federal Liberals for 34 years. And all the broken promises in the 2015 election I found very disappointing. And I decided I really couldn't help out the Liberals this time. And I decided to join the Greens. One thing led to another, and I became the candidate.
Okay, is there any other reasons why you decided to join the Green Party?
It was also, it was a personal reason. I have four daughters, and for my daughters, they were telling me, get with the program, Dad. We need to pay attention to the climate crisis. Especially one has been working in the field for a long time, started the Environment Club at her high school, and so that was a really big influence as well.
And in your riding, what community activities do you partake in?
I've done a lot of different things in the riding. As I said, I ran for the federal Liberals last time in 2015. And I've also knocked on doors for the proportional representation referendum last year. So if you look at the last 4 years, I probably knocked on more doors than any other person in our whole riding through all parts of the riding, because I felt really committed to working with people on the referendum and working on political campaigns. I started knocking on doors for this campaign in December, and so that's one of the big things I've been doing. I've also worked for environmental groups, the Land Conservancy, I was on their board of directors, and the Habitat Acquisition Trust, where I basically pulled invasive species out of their properties.
Okay, and David, you were the Executive Director of Innovation for the BC Ministry to the Attorney General, is that correct?
That's correct.
And what did that position entail?
It was about transformation of a justice system which in Canada serves wealthy people and corporations very well because they can afford lawyers. But most British Columbians cannot, and it's very expensive to use our courts. So the question was, how do we make them much more accessible, much less expensive, much faster? And so we looked around the world at different models of how to transform justice systems, and we picked from different places. eBay and PayPal resolve 60 million disputes a year online, so we looked at their online dispute resolution systems. Australia has a very good tribunal, which we modeled our civil resolution tribunal on. So we ended up bringing in the civil resolution tribunal, online dispute resolution, very new way of resolving disputes which didn't require very expensive lawyers and judges. And now we have a system for small claims and strata disputes, condominium disputes, which is much, much faster and much cheaper and delivers better justice services.
Okay, and how does that experience, how could that help your work as an MP?
I think what we need in the next 10 to 12 years is deep transformational change in how Canada's economy works, how we power our economy, how our transportation systems work, how our social justice, how our social programs system work, because we're not going to get to deep change unless we're moving on all levels at the same time. So that experience in the justice system with transformational change, I've seen how hard it is, but I've also seen how you do it, and I think that's really relevant to the Member of Parliament's job in Ottawa.
Okay, thank you. And do you have any other work experience that you think would be a benefit to your work as an MP?
Well, I actually started work as a lawyer in Ottawa at the Department of Justice in Ottawa and also at the Privy Council Office. And both those organizations have been in the news with the SNC-Lavalin scandal earlier this year. And I think the experience of working there was part of the reason that ethics in government and integrity in government have been such important things for me. And it's one of the reasons I joined the Green Party. I felt Elizabeth May was a different kind of leader, and the Green Party is not your typical political party. It's not like the old line parties, more of the status quo type. It's a party that's able to bring transformational change and that will take a very different approach to government.
Okay, so we're going to move on to talk a little bit about the climate crisis. Since the IPCC report was released in 2018, it has become globally apparent that we are on a strict timeline to reduce global carbon emissions in order to hold 1.5 degrees of warming. So as a potential MP, what climate action would you prioritize?
I mentioned transportation earlier, and I think it's critical. Especially in our part of the world, on South Vancouver Island, you see huge problems with traffic, slow traffic, and there are massive investments being made in the wrong places here. We're spending over $90 million on an interchange on the Trans-Canada Highway up at the Mackenzie Interchange. That project is well over a year behind schedule. It's $11 million over budget, and it's not going to do very much. It's just going to speed the cars to the next red light. What we need to look at is a major investment in public transit, and our public transit needs to have more funding, and also we need to look at how we shift it, how we electrify public transit. So it's not diesel or gas-powered public transit. It's EV, electric vehicles. China's done this. They've had great success with it in cutting emissions. Canada needs to do the same. So that's just one example. Transportation is a big area. We look also at our built infrastructure, and we're campaigning on a major infrastructure change, a retrofit for all municipal, provincial, and federal buildings, funding that, which will create thousands and thousands of jobs for electricians, plumbers, and others who will make our built infrastructure much better in terms of greenhouse gas emissions. Those are a couple of areas that I think are top priorities.
Okay. Yeah. And what would jobs look like in a post-carbon economy?
One of the things that's happening right now is that artificial intelligence, machine learning, and just technology is evolving so quickly that literally thousands and thousands of people are being put out of work right now, and it's going to get worse. We're not going to need taxi drivers, even truck drivers, as soon as 10 to 12 years from now, which actually coincides with what the scientists are saying about climate action. So we need to really look at how we change our economy. Mm-hmm. And that involves, I think, a huge investment in education, not just for young people, but also for people in mid-career. How do we get them to connect with the new economy? And the Green Party is actually committed to campaigning on free tuition for trade school, college, and university. If Switzerland and Germany and Norway and Sweden can do it, so can Canada. It's a major investment, but we need to make that shift in our economy, and we don't want to leave anybody behind. So let's help people with education, help them to move to the new economy.
And how would you pay for something like this?
That's a great question. One of the things is we have to stop spending money on the old economy. And in 2015, when I was a Liberal, we were campaigning on cutting fossil fuel subsidies. Taxpayers spend $3.5 billion every year on fossil fuel subsidies to major multinational companies. We should cut those entirely. The fossil fuel subsidies should be gone. And let's move that $3.5 billion over to tuition for students who want to enter into the new economy. And also, let's look at social programs. I mentioned social justice. This transition is going to be a real challenge, and we need to make sure, as I said, we don't leave anybody behind. So one of the things we're campaigning on, which is also a major expense, is guaranteed livable income. And to pay for that, we're going to have to change our tax structure. And it's not complicated. We just tax things that we don't want, and we take taxes off things we do want. So we do want jobs, right? So let's take taxes off payroll taxes. Payroll taxes are job killers. On the other hand, we don't want polluters to get away for free and shift their costs onto taxpayers. So let's make polluters pay for their pollution. So those are some of the examples of the tax shifts we need and the spending changes we need to make in order to fund these social programs.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. So the cost of living continues to increase, making it more difficult for individuals and families to enter the housing market. If you were elected as an MP, what work would you do to improve housing affordability in BC?
That's a big issue in my family as well. I have young women, 23, I have four kids, and they're all women, and they're graduating from university, wanting to go on their own, and it's very hard to rent in South Vancouver Island, and it's almost impossible to afford to buy a home. So what do we do on that? A key thing is to address housing supply. We need to figure out how we increase the supply of housing. Canada Mortgage and Housing Corporation used to have a mandate in that in the 70s to help increase housing supply, and we should build on that. that's a key thing for us. We want to look at how we cooperate with cooperative housing and also co-housing, where people own their units, but there's public funding to help them get there with that. Those are some of the ideas we have right now on how to address the housing crisis.
Okay. Your riding is also home to many veterans as well as current members of the military. What would you do to support veterans in your riding?
The Harper government made huge cuts to veterans' benefits, and the Trudeau government said they would fix it, but they haven't. And so what we should do is go back to the pre-2006 levels, where our veterans were properly funded through periodic payments and treated with respect. We need to go back to those funding levels, which is another significant increase. We also need to look at veterans as part of a social system, part of a family system. We need to treat veterans as human beings who are part of families, and those families often need help. The veterans need help, especially veterans who are suffering from PTSD. So we should take a more sophisticated approach to serving our veterans and not just treat them as sort of people who have done their time and are now away. They're still our responsibility, and we should pay attention to them.
Okay. And how do you think Canada should be using its military expenditure?
Well, one of the things that's happening is our military is having to deal more and more with climate emergencies. If you look at the news in the last couple of months, it's about the military evacuating Indigenous people from reserves. It's about fighting forest fires. And the Chief of Defense Staff has said more and more the military is being called on to address climate emergencies. And we have some places where there are examples of how the military can actually refocus on those kinds of issues. The Army Corps of Engineers in the United States does a big job on those kinds of issues, especially flooding. So let's look at that. And let's look at other expenditures, like the F-35 fighter jet. It's a $1 billion airplane. Is it really necessary to be spending so much on F-35s, a single engine airplane fighter jet, which is with a mandate to attack ground targets? Is that really where we need to invest, or should we be investing more in services to military families and looking at what's happening in the north, in Canada's north, where we're going to have more and more risk to our sovereignty in the north? So I think a major review of what are the military's priorities is something that's a good idea.
Okay. And lastly, this is the first election that myself and many other young people will be able to vote in. Why should the youth trust you with our future?
That's a great question too, because I think it's easy to talk about all the good things we're going to do about youth, but it's hard to actually deliver. And I think youth are at the point, like many Canadians, being a little bit cynical about politicians not keeping their promises. So one of the things that we're doing in a very practical way in our Green campaign on South Vancouver Island is we're bringing in young people to be leaders here on the ground in our canvassing, in our social media strategies, in our media strategies, and saying, we want you guys to be leaders because you probably know more about how to address this climate crisis than we do. You look at all the climate strikers on the legislature steps, the Green New Dealers, a lot of the leadership and energy is coming from young leaders. So that's one of the things we're doing, is enabling young leaders to be leaders. But we also need to look at programming and policy. And as I said earlier, the free tuition campaign that we're on right now is really resonating with young people. We're also looking at debt forgiveness for young people. So that's a major issue, is how do we enable young people who've run up debt to actually manage that?
Okay. Well, thank you so much for your time, David. Thank you, Jonathan, for your music. Thank you, Citizens Forum and Shaw TV, for having us. This was Tea, Tunes, and Tough Questions, hosted by Elise Robinson. Thank you for watching. Have a great day.